Saturday that Hannah was going to be coming to our house and playing. We were very excited. And so we were telling Katie that Hannah Georges is coming. And so I went on the computer and I found a song and I showed her and I said, Katie, this is Hannah Georges. And she said, I know, Mom. As in, you don't have to tell me, everybody knows. So the way I figure is that if the five-year-olds know who you are, then you've made it to the big time. So.
No, I don't. I haven't done a lot of house concerts. I've done a house concert once in my life before, doing the neighbor's dog.
At supper time, they had the catered supper, and we were looking for our daughter, and so we look around, okay, where is she? And then we went upstairs, and there's Hannah sitting upstairs, eating her supper, hanging out with Katie, and Katie has all of her red-haired Barbies set aside and showing them all. So she's made a big impact on all of us so far. So we're very excited to introduce Hannah Georges. Enjoy.
It's nice to play almost like you're playing in your living room to your friends. And there's something about that intimacy that's pretty special. Sometimes it can be a little, you know, that person is sitting right there, right in front of you, and you can look into their eyes and make weird eye contact, and that is, it's interesting. But once you get over that, it's, you know, people just want to come and relax and get comfortable and hear music, and man, I would love to go see, you know, an artist that I love and sit in a house and watch, drink wine and watch them play right in front of me. It's pretty awesome. That dark sky, it's so big. Isn't anybody wondering? Isn't anybody questioning what this all is? As I age, it sinks deeper in. This life is temporary. It's all gonna end. This is all gonna end. It's just a little love that I need. 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 There's an elephant in this room, and I'm white as a ghost. Show me the road, show me the road, all these moments become memories. I don't want to wake up one day thinking, what did I miss? I fear my own fate. I don't wanna wake up one day thinking, where the hell have I been? 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 my influence are kind of widespread. My dad was the first person that introduced me to music in my life. He was an amazing blues piano player, and just the influence that I had, that my sisters had on me, I think played a big role. Like, my oldest sister was really into house music, and my mom put me into piano lessons when I was 5, and I was trained with this method called Suzuki and played classical music. And then from there I started kind of learning how to songwrite and started singing and writing songs when I was really young. And I think a lot of like singer-songwriters kind of spoke to me. You leave a trail and the world will get out. That we're all lost and ready to kill. We're all lost and ready to kill. My first singing teacher like just opened up a whole different world to me with what I can do with my voice. I didn't even think I had the range that I had and the confidence and she was pretty incredible, very technical. She'd stop me after every sentence and be like, your O needs to be more O and your E needs to be like E. Like, it was just a completely different style. I wasn't this opera singer. So she was just very like, you need to sing like this. Ah! It was like, no, I don't want to. Yeah, it's like practicing your piano or your guitar or your drums. It's like you've got to practice your voice. You got to sing and you got to breathe and you got to tour and all that stuff to get good at it. There's no support underneath like these notes that I was trying to reach, and now I'm like, I can hit crazy stuff. When I moved to BC, I found somebody in Victoria who taught me a whole different method, but I really enjoyed her approach.
Pot of water, I mean.
You know, I don't want you to change who you are. I don't want you to be this opera singer if you're not an opera singer. I just want you to do it right, and I want you to use your voice the way it's you, but we just need to figure out the right way to do it. It was kind of hard. Like, I'd walk into a lesson and she'd know, like, the moment something came out of my mouth, what was going on with me. If there's something wrong, she'd know instantly. She'd be like, what's going on? Let's just sit down and talk for a bit. I'm like, oh, this and this and this. And it was just, yeah, she was pretty intuitive.
I've been living in Vancouver for the last 6 years, and I'm originally from Ontario. I've always been playing music, playing in bands. My mom put me into piano lessons when I was 5, and I just kind of had, you know, super passionate about it, but one foot in, one foot out, never really fully hardcore as much as I wanted to be. And so 6 years ago, I kind of made that move where I'm like, all right, go big or go home. So the song that I'm going to play for you, this is kind of a product of that feeling that I had when I first made that step. And it's called The Beat Stuff.
I need to go out tonight. All I've got is this feeling inside. Aha. When I wake up, you're already head. As the day rolls on, I'm thinking about you song by side. Oh, please sing along. You are the tune that keeps me right on key. Don't know what I'd do without you. I'd be all alone out there on my own.
the best feeling that I've ever experienced in my life is the feeling after you've written a song that you really like, you know, where you just want to go and go back to that idea all day long and just keep playing it and fleshing it out more. There's no feeling like that. So I really do love that. I think I like the end result. The writing process is, it's a challenge, but it's a challenge and it's good, but there's also parts of it where it can be frustrating. The structure of the songs are fully mapped out and in place before I usually go in to make a record. I would feel frazzled if that wasn't together. All the coloring and the producing is more of a creating process when I'm in there. My process has kind of evolved along the way. On my last record, I've kind of fleshed things out a bit more and tried to play with different things, so give my producer a better idea of where I want to go. But I definitely think the skeleton of the song for me needs to be pretty much there. It needs to be there. Yeah, I think for me, I like to kind of go in and be like, hey, this is what, here's my song, let's paint it. There's moments in my writing process where a song just goes bleh, like that. It just kind of comes out and I've written a song in an hour, and those are like pretty spectacular experiences to have. And it almost feels like it's not even coming from you, it's coming from somewhere else. But then there's moments where it takes me like 3 or 4 months or a year to come back. You know, I've got this awesome verse, but I can't think of a chorus, and you know, it takes time. And sometimes that can be like, oh, why isn't this working? You know, a reason why I write music is for people to just to get it or to just enjoy or get something out of it. So, and when I listen to artists that I love, I'm sure I don't understand like why that person wrote that song or know specifically what it's about. I just relate it to how it would relate to me in my everyday life, or why, you know, I bet you I have so many songs completely wrong, but I just like it for you know, for my reasons. So then somebody tells me if it's wrong, and I'll just like, cool.
Well, my name's Graham Walsh. I play music, produce records, and this is where I live and make music, both at the same time. She told me she liked my band. she liked Holy F***, I guess. And I don't know. Maybe, I think she was maybe looking for just to push someone to push her songs sonically, and she was looking for more of that audio experimentation and things like that. So maybe that's what I like to do. So
we were so similar as to what our backgrounds and what we really liked, and he'd put on a vinyl when we were just hanging out, and I'd be like, what is this? It was like he was just this music library for me of stuff that I just really got inspired by, and just really thankful. Like, I think it's super important when you're picking a producer that they like the same music as you. Otherwise, it might not, your ear kind of gravitates to different things. And I noticed that him and I, our ears are very similar.
We definitely talked a lot about records, even when we were emailing back and forth before we started working on the record. Just getting to know somebody is like, okay, give me some stuff that you're listening to right now, and like, check out this record. And we did that a lot, and we introduced each other to a lot of cool music and things like that too. So it was good.
It's pretty interesting because you spend like a month producing a song and taking a direction. You know, what if I worked with somebody else? Something completely different could happen with the song. And it's kind of crazy how things just kind of evolve and take shape, and you just decide in that span of time to make a decision and go with a vibe, and then that's what happens, where you can kind of take all different kinds of paths or choices to make a song what it is.
There was quite a few of the original vocals we kept, which I think was amazing, because there she is singing first take, like nailed it. And I think that was sort of new for her in some ways. Or I know singers are used to like trying it and trying it and trying it again. And we did that, and I was like, you're not beating your first take. Because there's something about, you're relaxed and you're not thinking about it. And so there's a lot of natural inflections and just tone in her voice, because she wasn't thinking about it. She wasn't thinking this is going to be the take. She just sort of like laid it. And then we built all the songs around these sort of first take vocals. And a lot of them we kept, because they're awesome.
His knowledge for just like the synth world is pretty impressive. I would notice we'd be like, doing work, and he'd have like a little like icon on his screen. He'd pop it up and he'd be looking at like gear. And I'd be like, hey, we're supposed to be working here. You're looking at gear. Like new, different synths and stuff, so it's kind of funny. He just like, he craves it. He just loves working on those instruments. It was interesting because it wasn't a lot. We weren't talking a lot. We were just like kind of experimenting together and just like, bouncing ideas back and forth. And he'd sit there and like get the sound of this, synth that we were working on, and he would sit there for like half an hour, 45 minutes, just playing with it until finally, like, that's it.
She was just had like, I don't know what to do with these songs, like blank canvas. Like these are the things that I've written. Let's go to town, and that is really exciting too, because sometimes when you're working on records, the band will get the songs all done up, and there's not too much creativity other than just capturing the song and stuff like that, which can be creative too. But anyways, this was completely open, so it was great. So we just stripped the songs right down to nothing and tried building them up different ways and found the coolest ways to make them. And it was a really, really exciting process, like for both of us.
This song that I have called Somebody, I wrote it and it was this like sad piano ballad. And I actually re-recorded it again because I'm like, I want it to still be a sad piano ballad. But I was so impressed. Graham just started playing like, do, 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 do. And like having like a Michael Jackson, Billie Jean,
like beat coming in with that song, and I was like, whoa, this is so not what I would have thought of, but it was so cool. And then we had, we had almost finished doing Robotic, and both just sat there and were like, what, this isn't working. And we had to like kind of dump it out and start all over again. And you know, I could tell that he was just like, what? But it was, you know, something that just had to happen. So there's, you know, all kinds of things happen in your producing stage. It's very hard to find like the right people musically, personality-wise. I've gone through like a lot with that and I'm kind of excited about the lineup that I have right now. I'm looking for, you know, first and foremost, musically, to connect with the people that I work with and to share, like, you know, there's just a professional, like, vibe that you have to have with your players, and then for them to understand that, for them obviously to really like what I do and to complement it well, and be able to just like serve the song for what it is. Like, I'm not looking for someone who's a virtuoso. I'm looking for somebody that just knows how to play their parts. And also just musically, like, understand and want to and get it. I don't know. So musically, it's very important. But on top of that, it's just important to be able to, like, just share, I guess, the same kind of, like, how just complement each other with personality and just like each other in general.
Can't really go on the road with people you hate.
No, but it's happened, for sure.
Oh yeah, it happens.
But you know what? There's been years of like just trying to find the right people and the right band, and I've gone out on tours where I'm like, did this just get worse? When you're on tour, you're giving a lot. Like, all day you're kind of giving and trying to get to your, you know, your gig, you're traveling, and then you play, and then you're hanging out with your fans after, and it doesn't really stop until you go to bed. It keeps going. So there, that moment of time where I actually do get my own bed and get to close the door and be by myself for a bit is kind of important. Or, you know, because you are, when you're on the road, your whole life is work. But I've just had moments like being, you know, 3 weeks into a 2 month tour and just being like, I hate this.
Yeah.
And I can't believe, you know, I don't want to like put down touring at all, but there's some times where you're just like, wow, you get into a rut where you're just like, I want to go home for a bit. I want to have space. I don't want to be around these people right now. I just want to, I see my bed.
Yeah.
And whatever it is, you're just having a bad day, or you're PMSing, or whatever it is. Yeah. It's just hard.
Yeah.
And I've had like meltdowns where, or I've had a show that I felt like I just shat the bed.
Yeah.
And it's been horrible. And I want to just run off the stage and cry.
Yeah.
So,
yeah.
Moments like that where it's just been tough.
Yeah, this is what you do to me. This is what you do to me.
Okay, favorite thing?
Yeah.
Great show.
Yeah.
Playing, I guess playing is the best part of it, when it just feels like, you know, you've really connected.
Yeah.
The worst thing is, I guess, just missing the comforts of home.
Yeah.
And yeah, I guess that basically comes down to it for me. I think for me, like, making records was a bit pretty big thing, and being able to do music completely and not have anything else to worry about, like, doing music was the goal, to just be doing that as my main and only, my only thing that I'm focusing on.
I can't forget my scars.
Best non-music job? I'd say teaching basketball. And one was, I taught basketball to kids, and then I also had to just run a basketball, like, game, or I just had to show up to the gym and, you know, turn on the lights, and then people would just come play for fun. It was like a house league men's team. And so I'd just show up and we'd listen to music and play basketball. That was probably the best job that I've ever had. All the sun peeks out to play. We all hope she'll make Thursday. If I wasn't doing music, I'd probably be working with kids. That's been like, growing up, my first job was working as a camp counselor and teaching swimming lessons and after school care programs. And when I went to university for a little while, and I was doing psychology, and I was thinking about going into a music therapy program. So I don't know, working with people, somehow incorporating music, would probably be something that I was doing, or I'd be an athlete.
Ooh.
A swimmer or something. I'd be in the Olympics. That was my dad's thing. He was a swimming instructor, and he had his own business. We had an indoor pool attached to our house, and we'd go swimming all the time. And I was just, I don't know, water was introduced to me when I was really young. When I was a little baby, I was swimming. I love swimming. Mm-hmm. Yeah. I said, all I need is this right now. I got that when I'm back. Got that since then.
My feeling is, if you're gonna put something out there, you gotta make it count. You know, you gotta do something really real and to make it heard. And because everybody's making music these days, which is great, but you've gotta, you know, I feel like, you know, let's just make a statement. Let's really try and make something and not just make a. I don't like beige mashed potato music. I like making music that challenges you and makes you think and makes you emote and gets a physical reaction out of you and all that sort of stuff. So I want more people to know about Hannah and understand. I know a lot of people do, but I feel like it's like, no, you don't get it. She's something else, you know?
This song is a song that I wrote for my mom. It's called Ode to Mom. And, it's in memory of my dad who passed away. It's just kind of a hope that she can move on from, you know, all that happened. Yeah, I would.
So let's try.